Okay, in this video, we are going to talk about hypopituitarism as well as hyperpituitarism, and then we'll also cover nursing care of patients who require a hypophysectomy. So let's first talk about hypopituitarism. This is where we have a deficiency of one or more of the pituitary gland hormones that are released. And if you recall, there's a lot of different hormones that are released by the pituitary gland. This includes TSH, prolactin, FSH, LH, ACTH, GH, and then also ADH and oxytocin. So there's a lot of hormones. So when we have a deficiency of one or more of these hormones, that can cause a lot of different problems in the body. In terms of the pathophysiology behind hypopituitarism, in most cases, it's an issue with the pituitary gland. So we have a pituitary tumor, there's some kind of congenital defect, or due to trauma. So trauma causes some damage to the pituitary gland. In some cases, it may be an issue with the hypothalamus. If you remember, the hypothalamus releases hormones that cause the pituitary gland to release hormones. So if the hypothalamus isn't doing its job, then the pituitary gland can't do its job. But in most cases, it's actually an issue with that pituitary gland. So in terms of signs and symptoms of this condition, we're gonna get a variety of signs and symptoms depending on which of the hormones is affected. In most cases, the growth hormone is affected. So when a patient has hypopituitarism, we'll often see delayed growth. Also, FSH and LH release is also affected often with this condition. So when we have decreased FSH and LH, we may see signs and symptoms such as amenorrhea in females and impotence in males. And then because we're not doing or not releasing as much TSH as we need to, which is thyroid stimulating hormone, your patient may exhibit signs and symptoms of hypothyroidism, which we'll talk more about in another video. And then lastly, we may see signs and symptoms of adrenal insufficiency because the pituitary gland is not producing enough ACTH. So signs and symptoms of adrenal insufficiency include fatigue, weakness, weight loss, hypoglycemia, as well as hyponatremia and orthostatic hypotension. So in terms of the labs and how we diagnose this condition, we would obviously take a look at levels of those pituitary hormones, but we also wanna take a look at target hormone levels as well. And then we're gonna do something called an ACTH stimulation test. So like we talked about, ACTH is one of the hormones released by the pituitary gland that causes the adrenal gland to release cortisol. Okay, so if we give a patient ACTH, we give them an injection of ACTH, if there's an issue with the pituitary gland and it hasn't been producing that ACTH, it will cause the adrenal glands to be happy. They're finally getting some ACTH and they will produce their cortisol like they're supposed to. However, if we give the patient this ACTH injection and it doesn't cause the adrenal gland to produce any cortisol, then that means there's probably an issue with the adrenal gland as opposed to the pituitary gland. So that's another test we do. And then we would also do a CT or MRI of the pituitary gland to try to identify any kind of tumor or abnormality in the pituitary gland. In terms of treatment, the patient is going to require hormone replacement therapy. So they may get medications such as corticosteroids, as well as thyroid replacement hormones and sex hormones and growth hormones, depending on where they have those deficiencies. All right, now let's talk about hyperpituitarism, which is where we have oversecretion of the pituitary gland hormones. The pathophysiology behind this disorder, it typically starts with a pituitary adenoma, which is a benign tumor in the pituitary gland, or tissue hyperplasia, which is overgrowth of tissue. And either this adenoma or this tissue hyperplasia typically takes place in the anterior pituitary gland, and it compresses the brain tissue and causes increased secretion of growth hormone, prolactin, and ACTH. So in terms of signs and symptoms of this disorder, because we have this compression of brain tissue, this can cause an increase in intracranial pressure, and this can result in symptoms such as a headache and nausea and vomiting. Also, because we have increased secretion of growth hormone, this can result in acromegaly as well as arthralgia. So arthralgia is just a fancy name for joint pain. And with increased ACTH, this causes increased levels of cortisol, so your patient may have signs and symptoms of Cushing's disease. And we'll definitely be talking about Cushing's disease in more detail in another video. And then those increased levels of prolactin can result in sexual dysfunction as well. So in terms of diagnosis of hyperpituitarism, we're going to do a CT or MRI of the pituitary gland, which will show this adenoma or tissue hyperplasia. And then in terms of treatment options, surgically, we can do a hypophysectomy, which is removal of part or all of the pituitary gland. We typically go through the nasal cavity, so that is a transphenoidal approach to the hypophysectomy, but sometimes we need to go through the oral cavity, like under the top lip or kind of there at the upper gum level. Medications that can be used alternatively include a dopamine agonist, which helps to inhibit growth hormone or prolactin secretion, or we can use somatostatin for acromegaly. All right, let's now talk about the nursing care and patient teaching following a hypophysectomy. One of the main things we need to monitor for as a nurse following this procedure are for signs and symptoms of a CSF leak or cerebrospinal fluid leak in the drainage. So some of the signs and symptoms that may indicate there is a CSF leak include a halo sign in the drainage. So when I say halo sign, I mean that there is clear or bloody drainage in the center of the drainage, but then there's this yellow ring along the outside of that drainage. If you see that halo sign, that may mean that there is a CSF leak. Other signs that may indicate a CSF leak include if the patient is complaining of a headache or is also indicating that the drainage tastes sweet. And then if you test the drainage and it is positive for glucose, that is also a possible sign that there is a CSF leak and that needs to be further investigated. In terms of patient teaching, we want to definitely teach them to avoid activities that may increase intracranial pressure. So this includes coughing, sneezing, blowing their nose, bending at the waist, and straining during bowel movements. So we're definitely going to be giving them stool softeners and things to help prevent straining during bowel movements. In addition, you need to let your patient know that a decreased sense of smell is expected for about the first month after the procedure. And then it's also recommended, particularly if we did the hypophysectomy through the oral cavity, that they do not brush their teeth for 2 weeks. It is okay for them to floss and rinse their mouth. And then finally, the patient really needs to understand that lifelong hormone replacement therapy is needed because we have removed part or all of the pituitary gland. So that portion or that, you know, the whole gland is not going to be producing those hormones anymore. So the patient will need to take those replacement hormones for the rest of their life. All right, so that is it for this video, and we will pick it up with more good endocrine information in my next video. If you have found value in this video, please leave us a comment, make sure to like the video, and subscribe to our channel. Thanks so much for watching.